Okay, so this is some primer on continuous and discrete time signals. I have prepared some notes, but of course, as usual, we'll just use the blackboard type of technique here as well. So what I've shown here on top is some continuous time signal. Okay, this is a general representation. It is defined for all time and takes all values. Okay. Now it has a Fourier transform XC, which is what we use to measure the signal in the frequency domain. Okay? And XC of F is this definition again, I think all of you are familiar with. Yeah? So this is the Fourier transform and it is plotted with respect to frequency and I have shown it as some general triangular shape. Okay? And of course I can only plot, this is a complex number. And I can only plot the magnitude or phase in a single plot and I will only plot the magnitudes here. And what is the property of the Fourier transform of a real signal? What happens to its magnitude response? It is symmetric. It looks the same for positive frequencies and negative frequencies. Okay? And because of this property, we can look only at the positive frequencies and not worry too much about what happens for negative frequencies. Because all the signals we will be dealing with are real signals. Okay. Now what are the dimensions of XC? If you have a voltage signal here, volts, what are the dimensions of XC? Huh? What are volts per hertz? See, if you look at it, this is in volts. And it is integrated with respect to time. So it is volt times seconds or volts divided by hertz. Does that make sense? The Fourier transform is like the frequency density, right? It is divided by hertz. So what it means is, basically it's giving you the signal strength in this interval, in a narrow interval around some frequency. So if you integrate the Fourier transform in some range, you get sort of the content of the signal in that frequency range. Okay, so it's like the density. It's like probability density. You integrate over some range to get the total probability. Here you integrate over some frequency range to get the frequency content of the signal. Okay. Now this is what we think of as the frequency domain representation of some signal. Now, can we calculate this in reality? For some things we can calculate it analytically, but for an arbitrary signal, what do we have to do? Can we get the continuous time signal like this? What do we normally do? Huh? Yeah, that's okay. The Fourier transform is defined for non-periodic signals. What are the problems? Let's say I give you some arbitrary signal. Or rather, let's take a more realistic case. I'll make an amplifier or some circuit. It is giving out some signal and I ask you to calculate the Fourier transform. Is that possible? What are the steps that you will do? What are the things that you will do to calculate basically the frequency content of the signal? We need a band limiting. Why?
First of all, I have to sample, have a loop and do
it. There are several problems here. First is the continuous time signal itself has infinite number of points. Okay. Unless we can analytically represent it, if the signal happens to be a sine wave, yeah, people have calculated this integral and found out the answer. Otherwise, you will have an infinite number of points and you can't really do numerical integration. So, you will have to sample the signal. Okay. So, not only do you have to sample the signal, you have to take a finite segment of the signal. Right? This is what we do. So, we always take a finite segment of the signal and a finite segment of the sampled signal and use a computer to calculate the Fourier transform. But that Fourier transform is clearly not what we have here. Right? So that is not this one, because this integration is going from minus infinity to infinity, and not only that, it is not sampled. So while the real signal is like this, we have to see what happens when we go through, when we actually compute it, what are the errors that can occur. So that is one reason to consider sampling. The other reason is, of course, you have something called an A to D that we discussed all day, right, yesterday. And the output of the A to D is all obviously already sampled, and you want to analyze the A to D as well. So for that also, you need to figure out how things behave when you sample them, right. So we already know something about it. We already discussed yesterday that when you sample a signal, the Fourier transform repeats. But we have to make those things concrete. And there are two reasons why we have to consider this. First of all, we are dealing with data converters, which deal with sample data anyhow. And the second reason is, even when we are dealing with continuous time signals, just for the sake of analysis, we have to sample them and take a finite segment. Okay? This is how you calculate DFTs. Now, for now, I'll ignore the analog spectrum analyzer, which is also there in many labs and is available. It works in a slightly different way, but not very different. But you need to do some analysis to make sure that what you are calculating is what you intend to calculate, right? I want to calculate the frequency content of this, but I've already modified it. I've sampled it and I've taken a finite extent of it. So what will happen to the signal? So that's what we'll look at, okay? Sampling part I'll go through quickly because we discussed it already yesterday, right? So what will be the effect of sampling? What happens when you sample the signal? What were you saying? So there is basically the fundamental thing that happens is the periodic repetition of the spectrum. Okay? And because of that periodic repetition, there are some frequency components that were not in the signal may come back onto the signal, which is aliasing. Okay, there is a possibility of aliasing. So you have to take care of both. I mean, you have to take care of aliasing. Okay? So are you familiar with this signal, the impulse sampled signal? So this is a very theoretical thing that is used. In reality, you won't get impulses, but you use it because it is a convenient thing to do when you are dealing with continuous time signals. You sample it with an impulse. What happens is you will get periodic repetition of the spectrum. So let me cut rid of this. Okay. So you will get copies at n by Ts, where Ts is the sampling period. Okay. So I won't go through too much into this because I think all of you are familiar with this. So let me not worry about this at this time. Okay. Now what we really do when we use a computer to analyze a signal or when we do A to D conversion is that we simply look at the values at some periodic multiples of Ts, which is the sampling period. So this again we discussed yesterday. Now this has a Fourier transform also, which is defined in a different way, because this was defined with respect to a continuous variable and xd is defined with respect to a discrete variable. You have a summation instead of an integral. But you can easily relate this to the old formula you had, which is xc of t e to the minus j 2 pi of t dt. Okay? So this t is like this n. Okay? N is the time or the index. And this nu, which is dimensionless, it is like f. Okay? So essentially you will get something like a Fourier transform, and what will the magnitude of this look like compared to the magnitude of the original Fourier transform? What will you see? So that is what happens. So if you look at the spectrum of this, as we saw yesterday, you will get periodic repetitions. Okay? And this nu is a normalized frequency, and nu equals 1 corresponds to f equals 1 by Ts. Okay? So basically if this the spectrum repeats at nu equals 1 or f equals 1 by Ts. Okay? Is it okay? So it repeats, but also there is a normalization in frequency. That's what I am trying to say here. Okay? So basically, your time and frequency gets scaled by Ts, right? So what was T? It became N. How are these two related? Basically, an interval of Ts corresponds to an interval of 1 here. Okay? So if you want to go back from the sample domain to the actual time, you have to multiply this by Ts. Okay? Similarly, on the frequency axis, you had some frequency f, and the frequency f equals 1 by Ts or f equals fs, this corresponds to nu equals what? What is the normalized frequency? 1. Okay? The sampling frequency corresponds to 1 on the nu axis. Okay? So this is what you see in the, when you take Fourier transforms of discrete time signals. There is no time as such. That's what I am trying to say. So you should not get confused. So you should just scale it properly. Okay? This is okay? So it gets, basically you have periodic copies of the spectrum, and also there is some scaling of the time and frequency axis going on. Because in discrete time, you don't really have time in seconds. You simply have indexes of the symbols, 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. You just count the symbols. Okay? I mean, at any point, if it is going too fast or if you have some doubts, please stop me immediately. Because it's not very clear to me if everything is very clear or nothing is clear. Okay. So, these are the definitions. We have XC, this is a continuous time signal, right? And the range of T is also from minus infinity to infinity. And from that we get a discrete time signal XD by sampling it at every Ts. And it has a discrete X axis, discrete N, but the range is still from minus infinity to infinity. Okay, because we have sampled the signal everywhere. Now, we can't handle either of these things. Okay, if you take a finite interval of the first one, it will still have infinite number of points. And this also has infinite number of points when you take the full range. Okay. Now, when you look at the frequency domain quantities, XC of F, which is basically the Fourier transform of this, it has a continuous frequency and it has also a frequency range of infinity. And when you look at Fourier transform of the discrete time signal, it has a continuous frequency as well, but the range is limited to half. Okay, it is periodic with 1, and for real signals it is symmetric, so it is enough if we take the range from 0 to half. Okay, which is what we normally do. Okay. Now we can't really store or calculate an infinite number of points. Okay. Because even if you take a finite segment of this, you will have a finite number of points here in XD, but you will have to calculate an infinite number of points for the Fourier transform. Okay. So what do you really do in practice? What is it? What is the function that you use to get the frequency content of a signal in MATLAB or any other signal analysis? FFT. How many of you have used FFTs in signal analysis? Okay. So it is really DFT, discrete Fourier transform. And as FFT, it is the fast Fourier transform. It's basically a fast algorithm to calculate the discrete Fourier transform. Okay. So there is no alternative. You can't calculate even this xd for all points. You have to calculate xd for only some discrete values. Okay. This is what the DFT does, the discrete Fourier transform. Okay. So let's now look at what we do in practice. That is, we take the signal, but only for some n points. Okay. So if you look at the first line here, I made it equal to the signal that I want, but not for an infinite number of points, but only for n points. Okay. So how will this modify the spectrum? What do you think will happen? So I hope the motivation for this is clear, because all of yesterday I was saying if you have a sine wave, you will have an impulse in the frequency domain, or you take the Fourier transform of this, you take the frequency content of this and all that. So all of that you should be able to see by simulating in MATLAB or any other software. Okay. But the reality is you can't take sine omega t from minus infinity to infinity. That's not possible. You have to take a finite segment of it. What do you think will happen if you take a finite segment? No, no. That is not possible at all. Right? Okay. But let's take a sine wave. For this you already know the answer, right? The Fourier transform is an impulse. Okay. Now this is from analytical calculations. Now let's say I gave you a sine wave, samples of a sine wave, and asked you to calculate it. What do you expect to see? Now for calculation you certainly cannot take minus infinity to infinity. In those cases where you can do analytical calculations, you can perhaps do that. But normally you can't do that. Okay. So what will you see? Now if you do the calculations and you don't see an impulse, that is a basic problem, right? The analytical thing says impulse and this doesn't say, this doesn't give you the stuff. What do you expect to see? Okay, so let's go and work it out and see. Okay, so there are some conditions that have to be right for you to get the expected answer, and there will be some errors introduced which you have to minimize when you take DFTs and so on. Okay. So this is what we do in practice. We have a set of samples, n samples, and n can be very large, but certainly not infinity. Okay. And if you take the discrete, and if you take the Fourier transform of the discrete signal, you will still have an infinite number of frequency points. Even that you don't do. What you do is, you end up calculating this particular function. Okay, which you can see, I mean, by comparing, first of all, this summation runs from 0 to n minus 1, because your signal lasts only for n points. And secondly, you don't use a continuous frequency variable nu, you use this k by n. Okay, so if you look at it, this nu corresponds to this k by n. And k also is a discrete values. Okay, so you take only a finite number of frequencies and calculate it only at those points. Right? So this is what you can do. This is what you can manage on a computer. You can neither take an infinite number of samples and do analysis on it, nor can you calculate infinite number of values. Okay? So you will take a finite set of points and calculate it only for a finite number of frequencies. Okay? So this is what you would do. I mean, if you have a continuous variable and you want to calculate it, if I ask you to calculate sine omega t, and then just for the heck of it, I ask you to calculate the numbers. You won't calculate it for 0, then 0.0.0000001 and so on, right? You will maybe take some intervals, 0, let's say pi by 6, pi by 3 and so on. And if I tell you that this is not good enough, then maybe you will take some points in the middle and so on. Okay, so you will take some discrete set of values. So that's what we will do. But in doing so, we have modified the signal. I want you to appreciate that point, right? It's not the same as simply getting the original answer for an infinite number of points. By taking only a finite set, you have actually modified, you have omitted the information in the remaining part of the signal. And by calculating only a finite number of frequencies, you may be omitting some detail also. So, which is what we want to see. And you will see that this can get very confusing. I can show you cases where you calculate it for a sine wave, it doesn't look anything like a sine wave. It doesn't look anything like an impulse, a single impulse that you expect to see. Okay? So, let's go ahead and do that. So, here basically I have defined this xd of n is my actual sample signal, but the samples run from minus infinity to infinity. And this xdf is something where I consider only n points and the remaining points I set to 0. Okay, so this is still defined from minus infinity to infinity, but except for n points, I set everything to 0. Okay? So, I can represent this mathematically by a product of my original sequence xd, which had infinite number of points and all of them could be potentially non-zero, times something I call wr. Okay? And this WR is defined to be 1 from 0 to n minus 1 and it is 0 outside that interval. Okay, basically it has 1s in some window and then it has zeros outside that window. Okay, and because of the shape of it, this function is called a rectangular window. Okay, so when I take n points and set the remaining to 0, it is the same as multiplying by the rectangular window. Is this part okay? Please think of every step carefully because it also looks like it's a lot of new material. So, and if you're not very familiar with signal processing, it can get a bit problematic. But this much of signal processing basics is essential if you want to do any data conversion work. Okay? Because you will be always going between the sample domain and the continuous domain and you have to calculate all kinds of things. So, is this part okay? What I have done here is I had a sample data signal xd of infinite length and I have set all points to 0 except for a window of n, and that is mathematically represented by product of the original signal times this rectangular window. Okay, and the rectangular window definition is given here. It is 1 in some window and 0 otherwise. Okay, so now that we have mathematically represented it this way and my original signal had some Fourier transform and this will have some other Fourier transform in general. I don't expect them to be exactly the same. Now this I think of as my golden answer, the correct answer, okay, because xd is what I wanted to analyze. Now how is xdf related to xd? You get the idea. I have the original signal and the original Fourier transform. Okay, I think of this as my correct answer. Whether I can calculate it or not, but this is what I wanted to see. Now, because of my limitations of storage and computation, etc., I only taken finite number of points of this and set everything else to 0. And I take the Fourier transform of it. Okay, let's say I am able to calculate this. How will this be related to this one? Plus some error, but what kind of an error is it? I want to calculate it, right? The point of doing the analysis is I want to see what kind of errors I'll get, if I'll be able to ignore it, if I'll be able to minimize it. Okay. How will xdf be related to xd? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So, are you guys familiar with this? If you multiply signals in the time domain, you will be convolving in the frequency domain. Okay. Or if you convolve in the time domain, you will be multiplying in the frequency domain. Is everyone familiar with this thing? So, what I am doing is, I am taking the actual answer that I wanted to get and convolving it with the Fourier transform of the rectangular window. Okay, this is what happens. Right? So I'm multiplying the signal by the rectangular window. So in the frequency domain, I end up multiplying the Fourier, end up convolving the Fourier transform with the Fourier transform of the rectangular window. Okay? So what is the Fourier transform of the rectangular window? Sinc. How did we get that? So that is correct, almost correct, it's not exactly right. So we can calculate from first principles. One of the good things about discrete time is it is summation, and summations are usually easier than integration, at least to some degree. Okay. So as he pointed out, and hopefully others also realized, XTF is the convolution of XD and the Fourier transform of WR, the rectangular window. Okay? And WR of nu, I will calculate from first principles. Okay? What is the Fourier transform of a discrete time signal? It is summation of the signal times e to the minus j 2 pi nu n. Okay? So that's the definition I used. This one, right? This is the definition of the Fourier transform. And this summation I will try to do because the summation has to go from minus infinity to infinity or 0 to infinity. But only n points are non-zero. The remaining points are 0. Okay. And this, the non-zero points are all 1 in the rectangular window. Okay. So, this summation, does it look familiar? It's a geometric progression. And if you have summation of r to the n from n equals 0 to n minus 1, this will give you 1 minus r to the capital N. Okay? So in my case, r is e to the minus j 2 pi nu. Okay? So this is what I will get. Okay? Is this a sink? What do you do with this? So let's see what okay, let me calculate it in detail. Which one? Yeah. Yeah, that's correct. No, no, it is not equal to 1, it is some complex number. And then, yeah, that's true. That's correct. But it works, that's all I can say. Let's not go into the mathematical details of it, it's very hairy, and I myself am not too aware of many of those things. But the answer is correct. You can use that formula, and it still works. Okay? So, what you do with this is, okay, this is the answer we got. This is the Fourier transform of the rectangular window. And there is a standard trick to calculate this kind of thing properly. So, I will take e to the j pi nu n. Okay. What will I get in brackets? I will take this out. So what will I get in the e to the plus j pi nu n minus j 2 pi nu n. So I took basically half of this outside, that's why I got it. And similarly, do the same thing in the denominator. J pi nu e to the j pi nu minus e to the minus j pi nu. Okay. And what is this? sign. Okay. So this whole thing, this part will be e to the minus j phi nu n minus 1, and this is, what is the upper thing? Sign of what? Sign phi nu n, and is that all or is there something else? J2, and the denominator is sin pi nu and J2. Okay. So this goes away, and what we get is e to the minus j pi nu n minus 1 sin pi nu n by sin pi nu. Okay. So this is not exactly a sink, right? It's a ratio of two sines. What is the value of this at nu equal to 0? Huh? No, it's not undefined, right? What is the sinc? Sinc x is sine pi x divided by pi x. What is the value of this at 0? 1. So this is not undefined. You take the limit and you get the thing, right? So similarly, what will this give you? The numerator and denominator, if you evaluate separately, are 0. But in the limit, what will it give you correctly? One. Okay, let's see. It is pi. Why? So let me evaluate only this ratio. And again, I'll do a silly trick to get the answer. Okay. I divide this by pi nu n and multiply by pi nu n. Okay. And similarly, the denominator is sin pi nu. Okay. I multiply this by pi nu and divide by pi nu. So I have not changed anything. Right. What is this? Huh? What is the value of that at nu equal to 0? It is a sinc function, it is 1. And this one? 1. Okay, so both of these give you 1 at nu equal to 0. And what about this? N. So this one, it's basically at nu equal to 0, the value of this is N. Okay. Is it okay? So that's what I have shown here. So I think a small mistake here again. This should be n minus 1. And I'll show the magnitude, so this part is not significant, not important. Okay. Sin pi nu n divided by sin pi nu. Okay. Now, sin pi nu n will look like this. Okay. The magnitude of it. The sin itself will look, it will go positive and negative and positive and negative. I have taken only the magnitude, so it looks like a half-wave rectified thing, right? That is the numerator. And the denominator is sin pi nu. What is the value of nu equals half? Sin pi by 2, it is 1, right? So it's basically one quarter cycle of the sine wave. Okay? I am plotting only from 0 to half of nu, because that's the only significant part. Okay? So I have to divide this sinusoidal thing with this. I already evaluated that at 0 it is equal to n. And also you see that the denominator goes on increasing as I increase the frequency. So it will go down. So it looks something like a sink, but it is not a sink. But it is something close to that. Okay. So this is the Fourier transform of the rectangular window. Okay. So it will have, this will have 0 crossings at 1 by n, 2 by n and so on. If I take n points, This you see, it is sine pi nu n. Okay, if nu equals 1 by n, you get sine pi. If nu equals 2 by n, you get sine 2 pi. So at all those points, it is 0. Okay, so it will, you will get 0 crossings at 1 by n, 2 by n. So this is the significant part of it. Okay, so that's why, in that way, it is similar to a sink. Also, although the exact function is slightly different. Okay, so what will happen because of this? So this is the Fourier transform of the rectangular window. What do you think will happen? So let's say, first of all, I take a simple sinusoid as my signal and I take n points of it. So what will I do to get the Fourier transform of that finite segment? I already said that I have to convolve the Fourier transform of the rectangular window with the Fourier transform of the sinusoid. Okay, what is the Fourier transform of the sinusoid? I have taken cos, okay, that is a sinusoid also. What is the Fourier transform of that? Impulse. So it has two impulses at plus and minus frequencies. Again, I will take only the plus side. Okay, it doesn't matter too much. And what will happen if I convolve the two? What will happen if I convolve some function with the impulse? With an impulse? Repeated? Yeah. So basically, if you convolve some function with an impulse, the function will move to the location of the impulse. Right? Is that familiar? So I have an impulse somewhere, impulse at let's say t equals 1, convolve it with something, whatever function you have, the t equal to 0 will move to t equal to 1. Okay? So similarly, this one, this function will move to nu equals nu 0. Okay, so this is what I will get. And I am getting this because I had earlier omitted the mirror image of this. Okay, and also there are two impulses and I have to add up and so on. So it will become symmetric around nu 0. Okay, so if I gave you this, would you say this is a sine wave? Right? If I took a sine wave, took n points of it, and took its Fourier transform, this is what I will get. Okay, so the result has been changed significantly and you should be aware of this. So this will happen any time you do any calculation because you can only take a finite number of points. Is this okay? So let's see how to get at least reasonably correct answers from this. First of all, is it clear to everyone what we have done so far? We have taken a finite segment of some signal and we have said that that is equivalent to multiplying the signal with a rectangular window. And now I calculate the Fourier transform of it like normal, but the only thing is all points are 0 except n points. Now that is the same as convolving with this function which is somewhat like a sink. So if you take a sinusoid, take a finite number of finite sample of it, and do this, you will get some shape of this sort. Okay? So the actual Fourier transform is impulse at nu equal to nu 0 and 0 everywhere else. Okay? And the Fourier transform of the windowed function, the process of multiplying by a window is known as windowing. The Fourier transform of the windowed function, first of all, one important thing I forgot here. This impulse has an area of half, okay, and when I convolve it, this is at n, so this will become n by 2, okay, just the scaling. So does this n by 2 sound familiar to anyone who has used FFTs and so on? So if you have used FFTs and take the Fourier transform of a sine wave, you will see n by 2 and n by 2, so this is why you get that, okay, the peak is at n by 2. And it is at n by 2, so that is just a scaling, we don't worry too much about it. And it is 0 at some points. And what are these points? Because the original one was a 0 at plus 1 by n, 2 by n and so on. Nu naught plus, this point is nothing but nu naught plus 1 by n, and this is nu naught minus 1 by n. Okay. So it is 0 at these points, not just this one, at any k by n, and at any integer multiple of 1 by n. Okay, so we can roughly speaking say that Remember, this is zero elsewhere. This is zero only at these points. So at these points, we get the ideal answer. Okay? But everywhere else, it is non-ideal. Right? So to recap, the ideal one has an impulse here and zero elsewhere. The actual one has some height here, okay, and zero at these particular points. But only at these points do you get the ideal values, and everywhere else it is non-zero. Okay. So essentially, the points at which you originally had no energy, now you have some energy. Okay. So this is what is known as energy leakage into other frequencies. And this is the result of windowing. Okay. So what do you do? Or we can go for tea. What do you want to do? Which is easier? So, whenever you have an error, you first either try to get rid of it, and if you can't do it, you have to minimize it. Okay? How would you do that? Is it tea time or should we go? I'm okay with continuing, but you want to take a break and continue, that's also fine. Okay. I think it's been a lot of heavy material probably. So is it very boring? Yeah, I think, see, the signal processing stuff, especially if you don't use it every day, after a long time you see all this math, it gets a little bit heavy. So you have to sit and work it out